Native Americans, the people who lived on the land where the United States of America now exists, before Europeans arrived and began colonizing it. In this map, made in 1991 but referred to pre-colonization times, we can see the continental United States and the main language and cultural groups of the natives that inhabited those lands, from the Iroquois to the Cherokee, the Comanche, the Shoshone, or the Karankwa, among many others. As the Europeans arrived in the East Coast and began settling inwards, natives began losing their lands, more and more. And this tendency of land loss continued after European nations were no longer in control and the United States were created, gaining their own independence. The thing is, this land loss by the natives should not have happened in the dimension that it did. And I don't even mean just morally, I mean legally. After American independence, from 1778 to 1871, the United States government entered into more than 300 treaties with the Native American tribes. Since then, all of these treaties have been partially or entirely broken by the US government. Fight that the natives have taken to courts and even to the United Nations, and sometimes have won. These treaties mostly had to do with one thing. Land. As the US became independent, they wanted to expand further west, following the concept of manifest destiny, and taking advantage of the lands they got off the British and the French, they believed they had the right to settle North America from one coast to the other. The problem is, people already live there, both in the unclaimed territory, but even in the one granted to them by the British upon independence and by the French with the Louisiana Purchase. And so, the United States saw natives as an obstacle, which they removed through war or, sometimes, diplomacy. The issue is that even through diplomacy, they broke their word, and the deals which they made with the natives regarding the ownership of land or the benefits of giving it up were not kept. According to Matthew Fletcher, director of Indigenous Law, the rule of thumb is every treaty has been broken. Before we go on with the video, a quick thank you to today's sponsor, CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream is a subscription streaming service, think Netflix, but for people who are really into history. It has thousands of documentaries and non-fiction titles from some of the world's best filmmakers, even exclusive originals that they make. Unlike most other streaming services, it's low priced, only costing $20 a year, which is only around $1.67 per month. They have a bunch of great categories. You will not be surprised about my favorite, history, and this particular title about Lincoln's elections really caught my interest, but there's hundreds of other cool ones to watch, and they add new ones every week. CuriosityStream is available on pretty much every single platform worldwide. If you want to try it out, use the link below or go to curiositystream.com/generalknowledge and get unlimited access to the world's top documentaries and non-fiction series. Also, when you use the promo code generalknowledge, you will get 25% off, so the yearly subscription will be just $14.99. Now, back to the video. The US government usually obtained these treaties coercively, meaning they threatened violence, war, starvation. Tribes agreed to give up their land and many times relocate. Relocations that, in many cases, led to the perishing of thousands of natives on the way, something that became known as the Trail of Tears. But they did so with the guarantee that at least part of their land would remain theirs, and in a lot of cases, that they would be able to continue to hunt, fish, and gather wild food on the territory they were giving up. Many treaties also included cash payments, mineral rights, and promises of healthcare and education, the vast majority of which were never fulfilled. But the thing is, they should have been. According to the United States' own constitution, treaties to which the United States is a party also have the force of federal legislation, forming part of what the constitution calls the supreme law of the land. In fact, in July of 2020, the US Supreme Court issued a decision that altered the map of the state of Oklahoma. The eastern half of the state is now, for legal purposes, Indian country. The biggest percentage of Native Americans countrywide live in Oklahoma, 12.9%, followed by New Mexico with 10.7% and South Dakota with 10.1%. In this map, we can see those percentages across states. And when it comes to land, Native American nations are now mostly reduced to their reservations. This map shows us the Indian lands of federally recognized tribes. There are more than 5.2 million American Indian and Alaska Native people who live in America and 573 federally recognized Native nations across the country. We obviously can't go one by one and look at all of the over 300 treaties. So what we're going to do in this video, in no particular order, is take a look at a few select treaties that properly illustrate how most of them were made and what they consisted of, why and how they were broken and not fulfilled, and what the territory of the United States of America would look like today if they had in fact been upheld, understanding why they can in fact still be forced to fulfill them today. This map from the Library of Congress shows us Indian land judicially established, so essentially lands in which an American Indian Indian tribe proved their original tribal land occupancy. And as we can see, it's a lot, spread around the land and divided into many individual nations. Should early treaties have been followed, much of this land would have remained under native control. Now, we can argue that many of the land would, even with the upkeep of most treaties, eventually be under US control, as many treaties actually gave away land from the natives to the US. But still, the amount of control and influence that Native Americans would have today would be much higher, and their numbers among the US population would likely have been higher too. When we compare it to that first map, it used to be incredibly more than it is now, and still falls immensely short of what it was supposed to be according to the treaties. So now let's take a look at a few of those treaties to understand why this reality never took place. Each treaty has its own specific conditions and reasons for its failure, but together they paint a general idea of why this happened. Treaties between the US government and Native Americans have to be divided into two time periods. From 1774 until 1832, they consisted of treaties between different nations. In the same way the US negotiated its independence with the British, they were negotiated, mutually signed, approved by Congress, and non-Native citizens needed some type of passport to cross over into Native lands. Effectively, it was as if there were several countries and nations into what is now the continental United States. But from 1832 to 1871, this changed, and American Native tribes stopped being considered countries, now being seen as domestic dependent tribes, included within the United States. And in 1871, treaties altogether came to an end, as the US House of Representatives stopped recognizing Native tribes as individual nations. But then again, if they were just not going to fulfill the treaties, why bother making them? There were informal agreements before this, but the first treaty officially signed was the Treaty of Fort Pitt in 1778, between the US government and the Lenape tribe from Delaware. The treaty was essentially an alliance that gave the United States permission to travel through the Delaware land, granting US soldiers supplies and even Native reinforcements. The treaty also recognized the Delaware tribe as a sovereign nation, guaranteed their territorial rights, and even encouraged the other Ohio Country Indian tribes to form a state headed by the Delawares with representation in the Continental Congress. Essentially, they would have been the 14th state within the new independent nation. Soon after the treaty collapsed due to insatisfaction by the natives, who in this event didn't fully keep their end of the bargain either, they instead joined the British in fighting against the US. The reasons for the insatisfaction were apparently two. One, some argued the natives didn't fully understand what they were agreeing to due to poor or ill-intentioned translators. The US demanded a full military alliance, the natives did not want one. And two, it seems these natives were discouraged by observing that the US were not fulfilling their commitments with other tribes, getting a feeling that they were only interested in their land. Next came the Treaty of Hopewell with the Cherokee and Choctaw in 1785, which ended with the phrase, "The hatchet shall be forever buried, and peace given by the United States of America." As we know, this was not the case. The Calico Treaty in 1794 ceded 1 million acres of land and sovereignty to the six nations to govern themselves, but this was eventually overlooked. The Treaty of Greenville in 1795 saw the Shawnee and Delaware tribes cede large parts of Ohio, Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, and Wisconsin. In return, the US would stop expanding into the remainder of their land. But the treaty was quickly voided, as the US ignored it and continued expanding. Andrew Jackson, first as a federal commissioner and then as president, led a big effort in displacing Native Americans and capturing their land. The Indian Removal Act from 1830 allowed the US government to grant land west of the Mississippi River to Native tribes, who agreed to give up their homelands. But this voluntary aspect was ignored, and through threats of withholding payment and military action, over 25 million acres of land were acquired, and many natives perished on their way to the new lands they were promised, and they didn't even eventually get to keep them in the long term. In other cases, especially in California, treaties were signed by US representatives in the area but then failed to be ratified by Congress, and so the natives would leave their lands expecting compensation as promised, but it would never come. In the Treaty of Fort Laramie in 1868, the US government recognized the Black Hills of Dakota as the Great Sioux Reservation, the exclusive territory of the Sioux people. But after gold was discovered in the region, miners and settlers began moving there, and Native sovereignty was ignored. In 1980, the Supreme Court ruled that the Black Hills were in fact illegally confiscated and awarded the Sioux more than $100 million in reparations. But Sioux leaders rejected the payment, saying that the land had never been for sale. Essentially, the United States wanted to expand west, but these western lands were inhabited by natives, so they either kicked them out through war or moved them out through these treaties. The treaties were either A, unclear, so the natives didn't really know what they were agreeing to, or B, full of empty promises that the US government ended up not fulfilling. Because of this, we are today left with a very unjust situation, where native people have been for centuries striped off their land and or insufficiently compensated when they actually agreed to leave. The issue is that, despite the US government choosing to ignore the treaty's existence and terms, they still exist, and many of them are signed and ratified, therefore holding legal value up to today. Unless they are revoked by Congress, a court that reviews the documents may decide that many of them should in fact be in effect, and demand that compensation is provided if not fully applied the terms written at the time. And there's an interesting additional perspective regarding the keeping of these treaties: environmental protection. A lot of modern native tribes have filed complaints in court against corporations or even the government itself when polluting industries are said to be placed there. Many times, tribal members have been arrested seeking to exercise their hunting and fishing rights. Governments and private interests have developed on hunting grounds, blocked and polluted waterways, and destroyed vast regions of natural resources. If native treaty rights had been honored, not only would the political but also the natural landscape of the US look very different today. In recent years, some courts have in fact decided it's time to start honoring the treaty obligations, and not only would this bring fairness and justice to the native tribes, but also a pathway to the protection of the environment, based on the legal principle that the land is of native property, and therefore cannot be exploited and polluted without their permission. An American historian, Mark Hirsch, stated recently, "The fact that you have treaties between the United States and tribes means that those tribes are actually viewed as nations that are sovereign, like any foreign nation." Then adding, "Treaties, according to the Constitution, are the highest law of the land, and many are still in effect. They are just ignored and unfulfilled by the US government." For a long time, the US got away with breaking its word and ignoring these legal treaties simply because the natives were not strong enough to both make their voice heard or present a threat to the state, something they would have never dared to do against Britain, France, or some other strong nation with whom they also established various treaties. But in modern times, with this issue being out in the open and recognized by many as an injustice, the US government might finally be forced to fulfill the terms of their own treaties, and the result of that could be a benefit to all and would at least be the fair thing to do. Thanks so much for watching this video. Leave a comment below with your opinions, thoughts, or corrections if you notice any mistakes. Do you believe native tribes will get the US government to now honor the treaties they have for centuries ignored, and would you like that to happen or not? Subscribe if you want to catch future videos, and I will see you next time for more general knowledge.